They say I live in the past.
Right, so here we go. It's like this next feature could have been made for this band. That's not just because I borrowed the title They Say I Live in the Past from a track on their second album, Sinners and Lost Souls, but also because Sons of Southern Ulster specialise in songs and stories that are deeply rooted in time and place. Hailing from Cavan, their debut album, Foundry Folk Songs, was described as a warts and all examination of the vagaries and occasional horrors of a youth spent in a small border town during the dark days of the late 70s, early 80s. Their widely acclaimed second album, Sinners and Lost Souls, was lots of people's album of 2020 and has recently been issued on vinyl and is, I think there might be some copies still available through their Bandcamp. So I'm delighted to introduce David from Sons of Southern Ulster. David, good evening.
Hey Dermot, how are you?
Very good, David, and thank you for doing this. Take two, this is. We've tried this before. The Gremlins meant that we had to go again.
Well, hopefully the cyber terrorists will leave us alone this time.
So that introduction, David, that description, is that how I should be summing up Sons of Southern Ulster, what they sound like, what they do?
Yeah, Sons of Southern Ulster, myself, Justin, started off, and then we pulled in Noel and Paddy, who we'd been in a band with many years previously. You know, we kind of drifted away from music. And I suppose Sons of Southern Ulster is really us coming back and looking at music and the whole purpose of it for us from a whole different, I suppose, a much more kind of mature perspective, really. So, I mean, I suppose it's an effort by us to capture the world that we grew up in, which is really very different from how things are now in the 21st century. So it's kind of late 70s, early 80s, growing up in rural Ireland and growing up, you know, pre-internet, in that bubble where personalities were larger than life because they weren't checked by otherworldliness or things like that, you know? So, I mean, I suppose when we started talking about what we were going to do, it's very much driven by narrative and by the whole, the notion of making a historical statement. And I suppose the music comes after that and we play what we can. I don't think any of us consider ourselves to be magnificent musicians, but we let the music follow what's coming out of us otherwise, you know?
And in terms of, you've got a back catalogue now, I know you're working on a third album as well, and we'll talk a bit more about that later, but do you have opportunities? Do you revisit your music when you're thinking about new music? Or if you do revisit your music, do you think about it differently than when it was recorded?
Well, I mean, I suppose once you start releasing stuff, you get to learn to live with imperfection. And I suppose for me, when I listen back to our stuff, it's interesting. I like it, but you hear things because you're so immersed in it and you kind of know, every beat in it and every note and stuff. You kind of go, oh, I wish I'd recorded that differently. Or you can hear a little melody maybe you could have put in. So, I mean, it's great. I mean, look, you know what they say about art and things like that, that once it's done, you let it out, you set it to sea, and it's not really yours anymore. So I think that's a good approach to have, is to put it out, let people make what they want of it. But there's no doubt you still have a sense of ownership. And I mean, when I listen back, it's lovely, but you can wince a little bit too and go, oh, I wish we'd done this or I wish we'd done that or that sort of thing, you know?
And I suppose I imagine that drives you on to do a bit more as well.
Absolutely. I suppose the other thing too is that, you know, so we're working on our third album now, and I suppose we're really spending a good bit of time thinking about what's the sound that we want. So, you know, for example, when I listen back to the first album, it's got a very definite sort of sound that almost sounds like it was recorded back in the 80s, you know. I think the second album is probably more cranky and more abrasive, and it's more kind of punchy. So we're thinking about what we're going to do next, and I think we might go a little bit more, might go back to more lo-fi stuff again.
Right, that's quite interesting, obviously. Now, sometimes I know people try and get the lo-fi sound by having a kind of a live recording experience as well. Not something you've been able to do necessarily, even before lockdown, even before COVID, because you're all in different parts of the world.
Yeah, well, I suppose, Dermot, you know, it's interesting. Although we tend to go for a pre-digital sound, the digital era has really made the Sons possible, because I mean, Justin lives in Boston, Paddy, the bassist, he's in Western Australia. Noel's in Dublin, and I'm up here in the hills of Clare. You know, so COVID really hasn't been the burden for us that it has been for other artists, in that we've always been kind of working like this and doing things virtually. You know, our whole process is basically that we talk about what we're going to do. We get kind of ideas together. I throw some music to Justin. He comes back with his stuff. And then it's just a kind of an organic thing from there, where it ultimately ends up in the studio. We record a good bit out in Boston, and also with Dara Jukes in Limerick, you know. It's between the jigs and the reels. It gets there in the end, you know. But I suppose, you know, with all this stuff of using digital technology, it really does expose music right from the beginning as to what it's like. I think that's probably a good thing, because, you know, if you're like four lads in a garage making up songs, you can get a bit lazy, and that you can let the power and the energy of the sound carry stuff at times, and actually it probably needs a little bit more in there, you know.
So Foundry Folk Songs, we're going to take a track from that, and I think this was one of the later tracks you recorded for the album, is that right?
Yeah, it was actually the very last, and we were at that kind of nice part of an album where you've got it pretty much done, and you're just looking, you're really getting a bit more experimental and thinking about things you could do. So you take a lot of chances just in your songwriting. So this started out as a pretty crazy kind of thing. And, you know, I suppose it probably ended up being the best song on the album, I suppose. People would say that, you know. So, yeah, it was the very last, and we were kind of cutting loose territory at that stage. So it just shows you, when you cut loose, sometimes the best things come out.
£24, that was the prize. The fruit machine at the pop end, where you covered your chips in sauce red and brown. Much as you like, because it's all watered down anyway. And the twins out back peeling spuds and smoking fags. Already man, and them not yet 13 years old. Big Tom and the jukebox, and Brendan Shine and Gloria, one day at a time, sweet Jesus. Brubettes and Slade, Glitter and Abba, the dancing.
Thank you.
faced and 15 I hyperspaced and disappeared, only to reappear halfway across the world. Middle-aged and lined, longing for all that used to bore me, embarrassed by all I once held dear.
That is the pop-in from Foundry Folk Songs and the album from Sons of Southern Ulster. And the choice of my guest tonight, David from Sons of Southern Ulster. David, you kind of touched on it earlier about the Sons of Southern Ulster coming back together and revisiting what you'd done before. So I know music has always been important in your life, but you've drifted away from music at a period as well.
Yeah, for sure. When the band that we were in back in the day, back in the kind of the 80s, 90s, broke up, I sort of fell out of love for music, to be honest. And, life takes over. You have to kind of grow up and all that sort of business. But I suppose I came back to Ireland in 2000, having been in the UK and in New Zealand and stuff like that. And it's funny, at that stage, I started listening to kind of, you know, local kind of folk stuff, and went to see John Spillane, for example, as a person I really like. And I just kind of realized that there's something really missing for me in my life. And I started messing around with the guitar again. And to be honest, Dermot, that's probably the first time I learned how to play guitar properly, you know. You come at it a much more kind of a technical perspective. And then you just, you know, it just kind of... it just took off from there, really. But yeah, there probably was a phase, I'd say, for possibly 10 years where I really wasn't listening to music too much. I think a lot of that 90s stuff didn't really appeal to me. I think the Arctic Monkeys album when it came out was just such a joyous moment. You kind of go, wow. Those kind of things happened and just came together. And I suppose I came back to it from a different perspective totally. More sort of musical. And I mean, I suppose the other thing too, Dermot, I would have been reared in all that punk rock music, and obviously you can hear that in the Sons, but back in the day, you were a punk or you were a rocker or you were, you know, a Ted or whatever it was, and like you kind of owned your bands, but you couldn't give any territory to the other bands, and there wasn't this kind of fusion that we have in music now. So as a consequence, I actually was kind of quite a narrow person musically, in that I would have known all the punk stuff, you know, inside out and upside down, but really wouldn't have listened to older music that much, apart from, you know, what you get with uncles and stuff like that, you know. So it's funny, when you come back, you realize I've just missed a whole, you know, massive amount of really fantastic music by having this kind of blinkered, only listening to really punky, new wavy stuff, you know? So it's when you come back, you sort of, it's really nice you discover all this stuff that isn't at all new, but is really, really good, you know?
Yeah, I'm interested in that kind of stuff as well, that question, because you've talked before about how at certain times when there's adversity maybe around as well, the music industry begins to sound more interesting again. And a lot of the bands coming through now, for example, from Yard Act to TV People and so on, are very interesting to you.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, sure, look, I suppose if you look at the really good pulses in British music in particular, they probably have come at times of been in depression or recession and adversity. I mean, Margaret Thatcher is probably responsible for a lot of good music in the UK, you know. It isn't necessarily attributed to her. And I think the whole Brexit business and, you know, the whole backdrop to Brexit. So it's not just the actual process, but the whole culture of the UK just right now is very confused. I think Brexit is now bringing that to another level, of course. But I think in that context, it's hard not to notice that. I mean, you know, alternative indie music's never been healthier, has it? It's wonderful. Yard Act, TV Priest, Do Nothing, all those bands, all that whole Brixton scene as well. It's absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, and the next track up will be a track from Yard Act. It's interesting as well that these bands coming through are coming from a tradition as well. There's, you know, there's influences from The Fall, from Joy Division and so on.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I suppose the Yard Act thing, it's that their influences are very much on their sleeve, really, aren't they? But they're doing it so well. And I love the different kind of fusion and how they're wandering out different kind of bits of music and stuff like that. Yeah. So look, it's clever stuff. It's clever stuff. You know, the other thing I was just speaking about Yard Act. It's interesting. I think they've only actually got 4 songs out. Looking forward to hearing that album when it comes out. They're playing in Dublin, I think, in November or December. So I'm going to go along to that. But I was listening to them being interviewed. You know what's really nice is that they really don't take themselves too seriously. That's a real asset, isn't it?
What a day to be alive. The state of everything. I know you saw the sign in the window. The brain fist on hollow wood. Sticky fingers on sugar glass. Are you really so desperate, desperate, desperate? Divides us as evil, but all that unites us is evil. No, all that really divides us is the binary hive mind and the instinct that it takes not to stick ourselves into every abstract object on the gallery shelves. Then the trapper came around. He was trying to sell me pelts. It was midday on a Monday, so all the smart people were at work. Trap music blaring from his furry boom box. The trapper tripped out after he flipped, said, shut your fucking trap, or I'll eradicate nature right now forever. Or I'll eradicate nature right now forever. So I bought all his pelts, all his pelts. It's a book by disc. Took out a small business loan and I bought all his pelts. I threw them in the boot of my car and drove downtown. I pitched up a store outside the office blocks. And come 5 o'clock, it was so cold that everybody needed one and everybody wanted two. So I upped the price and I bled them dry, cause that's what you do. And come 6 o'clock, I'd oversold, and my smile was made of solid gold. My many women and my ginormous mountain of never-ending blow. I saw the trapper disappear from my rearview mirror with no pelts to call his own. Shivering, naked and alone in the snow. The senseless charm, the gnawing guilt, the trapper's pelts, the trapper's pelts. The senseless charm, the gnawing guilt, the trapper's pelts, the trapper's pelts. The senseless charm, the gnawing guilt, the trapper's pelts, the trapper's pelts. The senseless charm, the gnawing guilt, the trapper's pelts, the trapper's pelts.
Yeah, the brilliant Yard Act with a track called Trapper's Pelts. And I imagine when you get to see them live, that'll be something special as well. The sound, that the production quality in that is interesting as well. Is this what you mean? I mean, it's high quality, but it's lo-fi as well. Is this the kind of sound you're looking for on the third album?
Yeah, I think the same guy is producing all these bands, is he? This is a cohort of really, he's kind of like a modern day Vic Mail, isn't he?
I think I know what you mean, but the name's gone right out of my head.
I'm just looking here. I've got a 12-inch EP by Yard Act that they brought out there just recently. They're pretty hard to get, actually. And the guy who produced them is a fellow, Ross Orton.
Yeah, of course, that's it. Yeah, definitely.
And that's recorded in Sheffield, but it's great. It's really good, isn't it? It's excellent production.
Definitely, yeah, yeah. Ross Orton, who produced, I think, worked with Working Men's Club as well. And I think he also did some Arctic Monkeys work, believe it or not. So, yeah, definitely great production. How does the production work with Sons of Southern Ulster?
So the stuff we do with the album is we put our stuff together. Then we go to a guy called Dara Dukes, who would have been part of that Limerick scene from the 80s, you know. And he was in a band that were on Satanta. I think they're called They Do It With Mirrors. So Dara's a little bit younger than us. I won't say how much, but he's a bit younger. So it's really interesting how that comes together, the different reference points and things like that. So he'll often say, well, what are you thinking about there? And I say, well, have a listen to this. And he'll go, well, I never heard that before. So it's really lovely, the whole interaction. So he's in Limerick. So we go to him, and then we go out to Boston and record bits and bobs and do the vocals out there, you know, with a guy called Dave Minahan. He was in a band called The Neighborhoods, and he also does stuff with The Replacements and stuff like that. And his place called Woolly Mammoth Studios. It's fantastic. You know, you go in. Yeah. It's a big, huge place. And like some classic instruments and all kinds of organs and brilliant guitars and stuff like that. Like, it's a playground. It really is. I'll tell you what it's like. It's like Willy Wonka's chocolate factory for musicians.
Wow. Sounds brilliant. Far cry from maybe 1979, where this next track comes from. A track and maybe a band that are underrated or judged harshly because of what the lead singer went on to do, which in some people's eyes was great, in some people's eyes was not so great. This is a track from the Boomtown Rats.
So, I mean, look, you know, it's great when the whole punk thing kicked off. It was fabulous. I was a little bit luckier than most people in that my mother's from Tyrone. So we would be dipping over and across. And, I mean, back in those days, Northern Ireland was quite a bit ahead of the South, you know. It was much more connected with the rest of the world, I think. And obviously it was connected with the UK and stuff like that. But as a consequence, we used to go up there all the time. And I had all these uncles who were a couple of years older than me, who are really into music and stuff. So I, you know, they used to get all the magazines like NME and all these sorts of things. So I always really kind of got all that. But, you know, it's interesting, back then it was a sense that it was music from somewhere else. And then I suppose, you know, we had, you know, Stiff Little Fingers, the Undertones, the Rats came along, and then suddenly they gave the whole kind of unique Irish bit to punk rock. And, you know, the thing with the Rats, it was just so wonderful when you would see them on Top of the Pops, and, you know, just thinking like they're our guys, and they're coming on, you know, dressed up in the pajamas and all that stuff, and with absolutely fantastic music. I mean, I think with the Rats, maybe one of the things that's missed is they were really good musicians. I think with Bob's journey with, you know, Live Aid and all those things, sometimes people underestimate just how good the Rats were, and also how good his lyrics were. I mean, you take songs like Banana Republic and stuff, it's an absolutely superb song, really get into the underbelly of Ireland as it was back then. Probably still applies a little bit, sadly, but there you have it, you know. So, yeah, so I mean, the Rats certainly would be one of the bands that stuck out, that you also felt that you had a bigger connection with, you know. And the fact that they were on Top of the Pops was just, it was, you know, just wonderful. And then I suppose more recently, Pete Briquette, through a friend, heard our stuff, the second album, and I mean, it's just wonderful. You know, someone like Pete would be a legend to us. And of course, he's also from Cavan. He's from Bally James Duff originally. So Pete got through to us and said, listen, I really like your stuff. It's brilliant. Would you mind if I mix some of it? And hence we have this EP, which has got delayed in the post, apparently. We still don't have it, but we're told it's imminent. It should come out in the next couple of weeks. And it's called Turf Accountant Schemes. So he's essentially remixed four tracks from Sinners and Lost Souls. He actually played a bit on them as well, too, which is fantastic, isn't it?
No, that is absolutely brilliant. It's great. And that's up for pre-order now on your Bandcamp as well, Turf Accountant Scheme. It should be released towards the end of August. There you go, hot off the press. Sons of Southern Ulster, August, Pete Briquette, Turf Accountant Schemes. And so, 1979, Someone's Looking at You, Boomtown Rats. Sounding great 42 years later, Boomtown Rat, Someone Looking at You. And when we were chatting previously, you know, we did this show before, it's out there somewhere in the superhighway. We talked a bit about some other tracks you could have chosen, and, you know, Sultans of Ping was in there, so possibly could Virgin Prunes, because you've actually played with Virgin Prunes with these music and pop culture symposiums at UL. Can you tell us a little bit about that, David?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So, Dermot, I work in University of Limerick in the medical school, you know. But when I'm hanging around the university, I tend to hang out with people in you know other departments. But I like the guys in sociology. So they've got a really good group there, which is called the Music and Pop Culture Group, and they have this really cool thing to do where every year they have an academic symposium, which features on music of a particular band or a particular movement or even a particular place. So in the past, we've had symposia on the Smiths, Bowie, Songs of Social Protest, which for me, that was a lot of that was about punk music, Joy Division. And most recently, we had a symposium on the Fall. So it's like, I mean, just to paint the picture, it's great because you get into a room with, you know, a group of about 60, 70 absolute fanatics, and people give presentations about perspectives on songs or, you know, the art of the band, and how that's influenced social movements and things like that, you know. But it's really cool because you just have so much fun all day, and then, you know, we have music at night. So typically what happens is we put together a bit of a band to have some music during the day, you know. So a collective of us who, you know, will do, for example, we'll learn some Joy Division songs, or we'll do a series of punk covers and stuff like that. So there's a whole band that came out of that we call Section 17. And you know, we've done various bibs and bobs. For the Fall symposium, we did a particularly interesting thing in that Gavin Friday was contributing to it. And then what we did was we recorded a song with Gavin. We did Slates, Slags, etc. You know that song. So we did a version out. So I mean, that was absolutely wonderful. But obviously, this has all been paused with COVID. So I don't know what's coming next. They were talking about doing one on maybe Sheffield music, which I think probably interests you an awful lot, and lots of it would be great. Or maybe doing one on Second City music. So we'll see what comes up. But they're absolutely fantastic events for music lovers.
Is there any connection at all between that and the fantastic cover, Klaus Kastengjold, who also did obviously covers for The Fall and so on? How did that connection come about?
No, actually, no. The Klaus thing is, Klaus, I'm sure people know of him. They certainly know his work. So they would know stuff like Perverted by Language and Creep. He did the covers for those albums. He also did the cover of Mother Juno, an album by, I think it's the third album by The Gun Club. And I mean, The Fall and The Gun Club be big bands for us, you know, in the history of the songs gone back, we would have been pretty obsessive about those kind of bands. But I was reading an online interview he did where he was talking about how he got to do the cover of the album for The Gun Club. And he was talking about, he says, well, actually, to be honest, I only met Geoffrey Lee Pierce twice. He says, first of all, he came to me through a friend and said, I want you to do an album cover. And he said he was very influenced by other other things that were going on at the time, as if he was quite intoxicated. And so Klaus started trying to have a dialogue with him about what he wanted. And he took a picture of two Mexican guys in a car and gave it to him and said, that's what I want you to do. So off he went anyway. And then when Klaus had it done, it's a beautiful cover, by the way. When he came back, he said Geoffrey Lee Pierce came and looked at it and said, I love it. And was so drunk he nearly fell in on top of the painting. So anyway, I just got chatting with him about that, and then chatting about The Fall stuff. And then we're just, I mean, he plays drums and things like that. And we just, between one thing led to another, and then I sent him some of our stuff and he really liked it. And I mean, we're quite cranky, you know. And Klaus's art is definitely cranky too, so it's kind of a perfect match. So we were doing that, and also I did a textbook of psychiatry. I'm a psychiatrist, so I did a textbook of psychiatry recently, and I wanted to make it a bit different, you know. So it's a narrative based textbook, and in that Klaus agreed to do sketches for each of the chapters. So each chapter deals with a particular zone of mental health, you know. And he did a series of sketches for that. And then with all of that, then we used some of those for the inner sleeves and the little booklet that comes with Sinners and Lost Souls. So it's a lovely collaboration, really it is. And he's great fun to do business with, you know.
There might be some vinyl copies still left on your Bandcamp as well, with the little booklet and everything. I think they're real collector's items as well as being a great album. Right, you mentioned Gun Club. You could have picked something from Gun Club, but you've gone with the Screaming Blue Messiahs. We're going to listen to this track, and then we'll have a little chat about this track and maybe a Sliding Doors moment as well. All right, here we go. This is Screaming Blue Messiahs.
I've been told I wanna go to heaven, but I've been told I'm my mama and my papa too. By my mama and my papa too. I wanna in the sky. Something on my mind. It's eating me up from the inside. Ouch. You ever felt that way? You ever felt like that? It won't go away. It won't go away.
I want up Screaming Blue Messiahs. You talked earlier about guitar and being a better guitarist at an older age and so on, and maybe being influenced by different styles. When you were doing it back in the day, it was possibly very simple. I know there was this notion about punk being 2.5 chords and that's all you needed, or 3 chords and that's all you needed. So what kind of guitar sounds have influenced you over the years?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose... you know, it's interesting thing, the guitar sounds. It's the, you know, punk came out and there was this notion that it was, you know, people weren't able to play and stuff like that. If you listen to something like Nevermind the Bollocks, that's clearly not the case. And in fact, you know, it's very interesting. We listen back, it's so well produced, isn't it? It's absolutely amazing. So you've got all that. So I think, you know, in the whole punk thing, there were some really quite inventive things musically happening as well. It wasn't just about the message, you know, but in the post-punk phase then, there's some bands that really stand out who are just amazing. So for me, I mean, I think there are go-to guitar sounds that stay kind of, you know, seared into your brain for forever. And this is definitely one of them. I mean, when I listen to the guitar playing in this, it's Bill Carter is the singer. He's like a man possessed. It's like Satan came into the studio and took over, you know. It's produced by Vic Mail, who's a guy definitely worth checking out. Very interesting fellow. He comes from that era of producers who basically, you know, would tell the bands to get lost and get on with doing doing the production. It's kind of from the Martin Hallett type thing. You know, the Joy Division would say it didn't sound like us at all when he was finished. And actually, probably just as well. I mean, what a masterpiece, the Joy Division stuff. But the Screaming Blue Messiah is one of my favorite bands. They really capture that whole notion of that area between reality and fantasy, psychosis, you know, that sort of thing. And I mean, just the whole sound is just so crazy. It's like kind of voodoo swamp stuff. Yeah, you know, it really is one of my favorite. I'd love to be able to get that sound out of my own setup, you know. I should say about this song, I was at my first cremation about 2 years ago, and the gig essentially was that you get to play three songs, you know. I was thinking, geez, well, I wonder what the three songs for me would be. But this would definitely be one of them to lighten the mood a bit, you know. I Want Up.
Yeah, that's got to be in there. I Want Up. That's very good. Tell us about this time you got to see Screaming Blue Messiahs.
Oh, yeah, I got to see them once. I got quite obsessed with them. Their first release was this six-track mini album. I think it's called Good and Gone. It's got all these pictures of aeroplanes on the front, and it's absolutely outstanding. It really is one of my favorite records. I've got a signed copy as well and all that stuff, which is very precious and framed just outside my music room to remind me I'm not that good. But whatever about that, I flew over to London, you know, which in the day was a relatively big thing. So this would be about 1984, and they were playing in the Mean Fiddler. And I flew over, didn't have a ticket or anything like that, just thought I'd be able to get in, and it turned out there were queues around the block. But thankfully, the Mean Fiddler was Irish-owned, and the bouncer was from Mayo, so we got chat with him. What's that? I thought, yeah. And of course, we got chat and all the rest of it. So I was with two other guys, and we got into the gig, and it was just outstanding. Now, they were at the peak of their powers, absolutely thumping it out. There was a brilliant mosh pit, and when I say brilliant, it was just a perfectly choreographed dance. Everyone knew the rules of the mosh pit, so it was super violent, but not in a way that you get necessarily hurt. Anyway, after about four or five songs in the mosh pit, we went upstairs. There's kind of a really nice balcony you can look down over the band, you know, and we're at the bar doing this, that, and the other. And there's some other guys there. And we just, you know, it was kind of one of those nights where everyone's really, really open and friendly and stuff. We got chatting with them. And it turns out that it was Paul Fox who was with Paul Fox from the Ruts, the guitarist. He had just got a record deal with his band at that time, post-Ruts, of course, called Dirty Strangers. So we got chatting away and all the rest of it. And as the night came to an end, Paul Fox says to us, he says, do you want to come back to my place, you know? So we were kind of there, and we're kind of going, oh, and we were tired and kind of, you know, just a little bit kind of awestruck, I guess. And we said no. And I'd have to say, somebody asked me some time back, what are the, you know, what are your top 10 mistakes you've made in life? And I have to say, like, I could have gone home and played guitar with Paul Fox. But anyway, as it turned out, it's a long story, but it's probably worth hearing. I was at this punk rock literary conference in London, but it's about four or five years ago. It was run by Vive La Rock. I don't know if you know that magazine. It's a very, very cool magazine. And I went over, and it was just brilliant. There was loads of people from the punk rock era talking about their experiences, just utterly funny now, you know, and really amusing. Lots of good heads there and all the rest of it. And of course, the two guys from the Ruts, Ruffy and Segs were there, and I don't know if you've ever seen them being interviewed, but they really are like Morecambe and Wise. They're an absolute hoot, the pair of them, you know. So anyway, then you take your break, and you know, in the breaks you'd be maybe having a pint or tea or whatever it was, and everyone would mingle and chat and all that business. So I was chatting with the two lads and getting my picture taken. Then I went to the bathroom, and when I was at the urinal, in came Segs, and we were doing our business, not really saying anything. And then I told him the story. I said, you know, one of my greatest regrets in life. And he looked at me and he says, you didn't miss anything. The missus would have kicked you out the minute you got back. So his wife was Irish, and like most Irish people, able to express themselves if they really need to.
She probably would have been having none of it that night, David.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'd carried that burden around for years on my back, and it was just suddenly released, you know.
Right, David. So let's go Irish music, modern Irish music as well, and really interesting artists.
Yeah, so I mean, I suppose just right now the alternative music scene in Ireland is really, really strong. I mean, there are just loads of really good bands, and I think, you know, maybe what makes them different, having been in the scene of the 90s when there were 1,000 bands in Dublin, so they said, and all that stuff, they're not really copycat bands. And I think there's a confidence where they actually do, you know, that they're confident about telling their story and telling their story in their own way with their own accents. So, you know, if you go back to the 90s, we did have a tendency in Ireland to copy stuff in the UK and America, and also kind of copy their accents too. I mean, one of the fun games myself and Justin have when we're together messing and we're kind of relaxing and, you know, having a barbecue or whatever, is we listen back to music. Like, we love looking back to self-aid, and kind of, it's amazing how many bands have got fake accents, you know. But I suppose Curse of Murphy and the Resistance, very, really good album from, I think it's last year, it could be the year before, you know, with COVID, your time just kind of flies. I mean, like, Sinners and Lost Souls is out a year now. It just dawned on me the other day, yeah, and you kind of go, wow. And we haven't played live, had a chance to bang those songs out there, you know. But this I really like this album in particular, of the ones that are out there. Great, great lyrics. Sung in his own voice, and the background music's really, really clever, isn't it? It's just great stuff. And it's kind of, it's out there in a way that I think traditionally most Irish bands wouldn't really have had the confidence to do, you know.
Probably coming back to the DIY element again, the whole digital band camp, etc. I know it's not necessarily physical releases, and there's issues with physical releases, but people can get things out much quicker these days, which is very interesting if you've got something worth saying.
Yeah, it's great. I will say, though, interestingly, that with everybody going back to vinyl, I mean, that's really nice. I was one of those kind of Luddite-y types who stuck with vinyl for maybe 4 or 5 years after CDs came out. And I used to kind of think to myself, most of the people who are blabbing on about how the sound's so much better probably can't really tell the difference. But anyway, that's a personal nasty thought. But, you know, an interesting thing about it is the demand for you to bring out stuff on vinyl, certainly amongst the people who like us and follow our music, is great. I mean, we're bringing out Foundry Folk Songs on vinyl now, and we're gonna add another song to it, just because there's a couple of songs got left on the cutting room, you know, on the floor, that we probably should have gone into it, to be honest. So we're doing that. But interestingly, what we're finding is, it's partly COVID, but I think it's the demand, is like the delays to get something on vinyl are really, it really does take 6 or 7 months now. So it's interesting, you've got this disparity between, I mean, you could go up and record something today and have it out this evening, you know, digitally and in those kind of formats, which is great. But when you get to the real thing of vinyl, you know, it actually really does take quite a long time, and you have to go through all those phases again, you know. Yeah, no, it is good. And I mean, look, the songs couldn't have happened if we weren't in the digital era, because, you know, apart from the geographical distance, the way we do things is we like to be separate and then come together. That's a much better way of doing, of creating music for us, you know.
Right, so we're definitely going to be spoiled. Foundry Folk Songs on vinyl, and the third album, well, obviously the EP coming out, Turf Accountant Schemes. You talked about people that support bands like yourselves and so on. There's a real generosity out there as well that links in with the band camp and the independent ways of putting it all together. I'm thinking in particular of some Facebook groups like the What's Really Going On Fontaines DC fan page on Facebook. I've practiced that now. I can say it so easily. But there's a real generosity of spirit among members there and you know, the moderators and all of that, kind of encouraging people to listen to and support other music.
Oh, they're totally cool. I have to say that's it's really easy. I mean, you know, aside from everything else, you get to discover a whole load of stuff that maybe you haven't been aware of. And I mean, I think, you know, with the Fontaines group in particular, you've got a lot of people who are really quite like-minded, and also there's a lot of really generous souls there too, isn't there? So, I mean, they've been good to us in playing our stuff and, you know, they have listening, what do you call them? Listening parties and things like that that we've been part of. But it's a great way to actually get to hear what people think. And, you know, I suppose, Dermot, you know, with the Sons, when we kicked off, we kind of didn't have a sense that anyone was, it wasn't really for other people, the music. It was, and we also thought that we're writing about small town, you know, Bailaborough County, Cavan in the 80s. Is that really going to connect with anyone else? But, you know, it's been really wonderful the way, you know, people get it, not just in Ireland, but also abroad, that whole notion of what it was like back then, and enjoy it, you know. But, you know, whatever about all of that, I think we're probably quite robust in terms of we're not too worried about how much people like us or don't. And we certainly don't do things. We don't do any cheap tricks to please people. It's really about the thing has to be what it is. And good or bad, that's what we're going to do. But equally, I suppose I'd say getting good feedback really does spur you on as well, you know. So much as we like to think we're kind of real tough and isolated, we do our own thing and, you know, all that stuff, getting a bit of love back really does help and encourage you. And, you know, I think it helps you to do better music as well. So the Fontaines page, I mean, it's great, the chats you see when they bounce off there, they get really, really into some fine detail about stuff, which is great, you know.
Yeah, and I love to see where the fans, if you like, are interacting with the artists as well, from Enola Gay to Sly Rides to Turnstiles and Blowtorch Records and so on, and yourselves as well, obviously, getting on there and chatting. Right, we're going to end part one of our chat. We'll be back next week with part two, and because the next week will be slightly shorter, that means that the second half of the second hour, just Irish music. So whenever a guest goes into a second week, the second half of the second hour, how complicated can I make this, will be from Irish bands, Irish indie, alternative, punk, post-punk, from the past, the present and the future. I managed to do the future recently as well. Very impressed with myself. So just to review what we've had tonight from David Marr from Sons of Southern Ulster. First up, we took the pop in from Foundry Folk Songs, which we found out will be coming out in vinyl. And they also have Turf Accountant Schemes, which you can pre-order on Bandcamp. That'll be the EP coming out very soon. Then we took the Trapper's Pelts from Yard Act. The third track was from 1979, Someone's Looking at You, the Boomtown Rats. Then the Sliding Doors moment, I Want You, the Screaming Blue Messiahs, or the Get Out of My House, What Are You Doing Here at This Hour of the Night moment. And now we're going to take Kirst Murphy versus the Resistance, and the track is called Climb. We'll be back at the same time next week, and looking forward to chatting again to David, finding out a bit more about three more songs that we've got, including something from the new EP. Okay, until next week, thank you very much for listening in. Spread the word. If you know anyone that would like to listen to this and has not listened to it, then it is repeated a few times, so check out my Twitter. But there will also be a Mixcloud link going up very, very soon. Until next week, take care. Good night.
Indie Rocks Radio. Born in Manchester, raised across the world.